And as we are in the midst of geopolitical conflict while still reeling from the pandemic, questions on whether globalization and traditional trade alliances still work. Joining us today to discuss trade possibilities for the Philippines and the ASEAN under a volatile geopolitical landscape is analyst and professor Don McLean Hill. Good afternoon, Don. Thanks a lot for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Mr. Stanley. Always a pleasure to converse with you.
All right. As we are monitoring geopolitical developments in Asia in the military and defense context first, there are also rising discussions on the impact of the changes in geopolitical geopolitics, in particular on trade and the economy. What's taking shape out there, Don? I mean, do you see economic alliances among countries deliberately moving away from China or at least minimizing their dependence on China? What are you seeing?
Right. Thank you. That's an excellent first question. And, you know, we have to understand that despite its importance, you know, diversifying away from China, rerouting supply chains from China would be absolutely expensive, a long-term process, and equally challenging. Right. So there have been several initiatives that have been taking place, but I think it's important to take note of an equally new and large scheme process that is taking place. And that is the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework in the past few weeks recently, you know, proposed a supply chain agreement. So the IPEF includes the U.S., India, Japan, the Philippines, Vietnam. So 14 countries. Right. So, of course, given the disruptions of the COVID-19 pandemic, concerns over the volatility of supply chains during crisis in China. So there would be a sort of initiative to increase the resilience, efficiency, and productivity of supply chains through collaborative activities under the IPEF. So, you know, this proposed agreement, you know, also aims to spearhead cooperation, mobilize investments, and maintain the availability of skilled workers. So, you know, the IPEF Supply Chain Council would also be developed to report progress and the agreements. And two other institutions, such as the IPEF Supply Chain Crisis Response Network and the IPEF Labor Rights Advisory Board, would be centered on supporting in terms of crisis for supply chains and information sharing. So, you know, this would still be translated to a final text. So we'd see how this play out.
All right. So that is a pretty delicate balance there. Now, Don, the pandemic taught nations a lot of things when it comes to trade and economic ties with the disruptions, proving that by globalization, which was the mode in the past, we have cemented links that have resulted in catastrophic consequences once disrupted. Now, economies are working towards regionalization. But as we know, not everyone in the region is a friend. How do you think regionalization efforts should or would work?
Right. Now, we have to understand that when we look into the global political economy, right, there are questions about altering or reversing the trends of globalization, right, and economic activity and the dominance of the dollar towards more region-centric or geographically-centered approaches, right? So when we are looking at the trajectory of the global political economy, we're looking more into reformation rather than a complete reversal of traditional international economic institutions. So there would be trade-offs. So of course, when we're looking into the political economic shocks brought by the pandemic, the ongoing war in Ukraine, the spillover of sanctions towards the developing world, you know, there have been attempts by major economies, particularly in the global south, such as India, the China, the UAE, Saudi Arabia, to really de-dollarize, you know, to a certain extent for both oil and non-oil commodities. However, you know, while BRICS currencies, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, have slowly and steadily risen, you know, since the beginning of the 21st century, it's important not to underestimate the role of the dollar, the dominance of the dollar, which clocks in at 59%, you know, in terms of the global foreign exchange as of 2021. So rather than displacing traditional institutions and financial engagements, we may witness a more multipolar currency pattern leading to a diversification, more options for international payment structures.
All right. Now, with that reality, bigger economies, perhaps like the EU and the United States, are also learning valuable lessons in terms of their dependence on China and even Russia, and are looking to partnerships with other countries like India, for instance, for a bulk of manufacturing commodities, especially in the chips and the tech spaces previously consigned to China. Now, how can countries like India, for instance, take advantage of this opportunity presented by the shifts in these economic alliances?
Right. In relation to the chips, of course, there are opportunities and challenges that continue to fold the events that are taking place. So as we are all aware, China and the U.S. are locked in this sort of chip war. Mm. And just recently, just a few days ago, China imposed export controls on gallium and germanium, very crucial for making semiconductors. Right. On the other hand, you know, while China is not yet able to produce advanced semiconductors, right? Mm-hmm. So the U.S., on the other hand, tried to restrict it. And this creates more opportunities for countries like India, as you have mentioned, which aims to make domestic microchips by the end of 2024. But however, you know, to handle semiconductor plants, talents will initially come from, you know, overseas, abroad, and gradually, you know, this knowledge and expertise will simmer down and fall deep within the domestic level, where countries like India will be able to develop it within their own country. In fact, Japanese and companies from Taiwan are also exploring investment options in India. But this will take time, you know, for the mid to long term. So for the short to mid term, we're looking into how the alleviation of the chip war between China and the U.S. would play out. And that would really have significant long-term implications.
What's your outlook on China, Don? Because years before the pandemic, China's Belt and Road Initiative was, well, touted as one monumental move towards China's becoming a major economic powerhouse. And that, at the outset, is what was the infrastructure was for, but there was also really a push for products from China, symbolizing its increasing economic dominance, moving away from that dream. Now, as the economy remains down, as we know for a fact that China's in recession, what do you is the future of that Belt and Road Initiative?
Right, it's very interesting that you've asked. You know, the Belt and Road Initiative is in fact one of the major elements in Chinese foreign policy of today under President Xi Jinping, and that is to promote Chinese influence through economic engagements and infrastructure. It seeks to tap into the increasing infrastructure development deficit throughout the international system. But however, you know, the BRI faces issues linked to transparency and sustainability. You know, Beijing disregards international macroeconomic stability. It funds unsustainable projects for countries with low or non-existing credit ratings. And, you know, to add to that, you know, the increasing reliance of countries on Chinese technology also continues to draw them deeper within China's political and economic sphere of influence. You know, we've heard about debt traps for the past few years, but looking into contemporary issues, you look into the economic crisis in Sri Lanka, in Pakistan, in Laos, and, you know, interestingly, three of them are China's crucial economic partners. Mm-hmm. And this has also created concerns on the sustainability of depending too much on China economically. So there is some sort of scale back we are looking into now from China towards its mega infrastructure investments. You know, these have been plans to turn large projects into more compact ones. And then given that China is not really making a lot of money by investing in low-income countries, there's no guarantee of return. You know, there comes the question whether such engagements are really tailored towards a security strategic end rather than a collective development initiative. So this is something that continues to mar the reputation of the BRI. However, it will continue to go on until there is no concrete initiative, concrete alternative. The G7, for example, tried to churn out a project after project for the past few years, but none of them really took off. And that's the problem. And that continues to provide incentives for China to remain unfazed in terms of its BRI, despite its complications. Mm-hmm.
All right, let's talk about the Philippine situation now, Don. With its escalating territorial row with China, leaders of both countries are still claiming they can set aside their political differences or geopolitical differences while other collaborations in trade can continue. Now, is it really possible to keep the two as separate affairs? I mean, geopolitical differences and trade.
Exactly. That's an excellent question, Mr. Stanley. You know, realistically speaking, politics and economics are two sides of the same coin. Mm-hmm. You know, making it increasingly intertwined, especially at a time, mm-hmm. you know, when the world is highly interdependent, it is experiencing that level of high interdependence. But we must also take a note of power asymmetry and political realities from a very rational point mm-hmm. of view, right? So from my understanding and based on what I call proactive autonomy, you know, what Manila is doing now is that it is trying to create a more conducive level playing field vis-a-vis China to negotiate more on the security level more effectively, right? So we are enhancing our defense networks with the US, Japan, Australia, European countries, India, and territorial defense capacity, enhancing the Philippine Defense Modernization Program. But at the same time, we continue to signal our intent towards China that we are willing to maintain open diplomatic channels and to illustrate that we tend to solve our existing outstanding problems through diplomatic negotiations. So in order to do that, that's quite tricky. You know, we have to create conditions that would add more pressure on China to make it realize that it can't just do as it pleases without incurring political costs. So therefore, this process will need consistency, patience, and open-mindedness mm-hmm. from Manila's point of view, because it's trying to signal at the same time the role of defense for its borders without provoking China towards a more offensive point of view, but at the same time, seeking to resolve the issue through negotiation. And for negotiation, you'd need a level playing field. And that's what I think we are trying to do mm-hmm. by shoring off our external resources as well.
Don, it's a reality that trade-wise, the Philippines is in a weaker position if you talk about the size of our exports to China against China's exports to the Philippines. Now, do you see this changing as President Marcos now wants to improve export numbers by strategic partnerships with China in spite of the territorial row?
Right, we're quite aware that we are quite dependent on our imports. Okay, the Philippines is a net importing country, which makes it, it makes it challenging for us to right away diversify our sources of import, because we have to look into the price, right? And at the same time, how these prices would impact the national economic status of the Philippines. You look at inflation rates, you look into the rate of poverty, food insecurity, a lot of factors that you have to take note of. So what we need to do now, and I believe that President Marcos Jr. is heading towards the right direction, is to bolster our political and economic cooperation with other countries that could offer similar incentives in terms of imports, for example, but also in a more sustainable way that would not lead us into questioning the strategic value or the strategic concerns related into deepening such cooperation. And I believe that President Marcos Jr. himself has reiterated this when he was talking to new ambassadors of the Philippines, that we need to strengthen our economic partnerships with non-traditional partners as well. So I think this is the overall initiative.
Okay, Don, lastly, and perhaps very quickly, you mentioned July 7, that was the anniversary of our UNCLOS win, but China still repeatedly ignoring that decision by the United Nations, saying it does not honor it. Precisely on that 7th-year anniversary, China even reiterated it does not honor the ruling. And now, former Solicitor General Hardelesa proposing to file a new case before the United Nations against China. Now, he was also part of that first team that got us the arbitral ruling. Now, do you see this as something that could further support a case perhaps that we already won?
Well, you know, there is no question that what we are saying and what we are doing is definitely reflecting on our legitimate interests based on international law and UNCLOS. But the problem here is that today's China is largely fueled by active nationalism, all right? So the regime its success at home will depend on domestic support. And in fact, we have to understand, despite contrary statements, China's threat perception resonates from within rather than from abroad, right? So if the regime decides to soften its position at the international level, it worries of being looked at as weak at home and thus leading to challenges to domestic power and its image at home, right? And it's because of this that we would see that it would maybe quite difficult for China, or it may be unwilling, you know, to accept legitimate rulings such as that, even though it is objective, it is based on international law, but it's unwilling to do that because of its own concerns based on its narrowly driven power ambitions. So that's its challenge. You know, and we may look into this escalation more and more, you know, as China continues to power its global ambitions.
All right. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for now. Don McLean Hill, thank you so much for being with us today. Hope we can talk to you again soon.
Absolutely, sir. Thank you so much.